Yes, ma'am. Start menu.
Okay, na. Kashinath.
Start menu.
Kashinath.
Yes, ma'am. Chapan.
Yes. You say start. Kashinath.
Start the class menu.
Madam, shall I start the class, madam?
Kashinath?
Yes, madam.
Yes. Sarada?
Madam.
Yes, you can start.
Okay, madam. Good morning, all. This is Sharada, PGT in Bioscience, TSRJC, Girls, Kodakanla. Welcome you all to my online class. In Structural Organization in Animals unit, we have already completed the topics of level of organization, symmetry, coelom, and animal tissues, some topics. In animal tissue, we have completed up to epithelium and connective tissue, some topic. So today we are going to discuss about supportive tissue, that is the skeletal tissue. So let's start the class. Okay, so this is the classification of the connective tissue. Already we have discussed yesterday. So in connective tissue, so there are three types are there. Connective tissue proper and supporting tissue and fluid connective tissue. So in the previous class, we have discussed about the loose connective tissue, that is areolar, adipose, and reticular. The remaining portion is a dense connective tissue we have to discuss today, okay? That is regular, irregular, and elastic, okay? So today's class is about the dense connective tissue. So let's go for the topic. Here. The dense connective tissue, the term itself indicating that dense means a thickness, okay? The tissue consists of more fibers but fewer cells. It has very little ground substances. So again, the dense connective tissue is divided into three types: dense regular, dense irregular, and elastic, okay? Dense regular, dense irregular, and elastic. First, we go for the dense regular connective tissue. In this tissue, the collagen fibers are arranged parallel to one and another in bundles. So regular means they are arranged in a regular manner. So collagen fibers are arranged in a regular manner in dense regular connective tissue. Tendons, so which attach to the skeletal muscles to bone. Usually tendon means the muscle which connect with the bone is known as a tendon. And ligament, ligament means which attach bone to another bone. Okay, so this is about the dense regular connective tissue. Now go for the dense irregular connective tissue. In this type of connective tissue, bundle of collagen fibers are irregularly arranged. So periosteum and endosteum. Periosteum, so in the coming topic, that is the bone. So the fibrous connective tissue which is covering the bone is known as the periosteum and endosteum, which are arranged in the irregular manner. So these are the best example for the dense irregular connective tissue. And heart walls are made up of dense irregular connective tissue. Okay, so this is about the dense regular and irregular. Okay, once again I repeat. So here, connective tissue which is in a dense manner, means in a thick manner, is known as, means more fibers but fewer cells. So again it is divided into three types, that is the dense regular and dense irregular and elastic. Now coming to know about the dense regular means, in this tissue, collagen fibers are arranged parallel to one another in bundles. Tendon, a muscle which having with a link with the bone, and ligament, a bone having link with the another bone. So the particular portions we are able to see the dense regular connective tissue. Dense irregular connective tissue. In this type of connective tissue, the bundles of collagen fibers are irregularly arranged. Periosteum and endosteum. So which are the coverings of the bone are having the dense irregular connective tissue, and as well as heart walls are made up of with dense irregular connective tissue. Okay, now go for the next one. The third one is the elastic connective tissue. Elastic, the meaning itself, it present in that only. It is mainly made up of elastic fibers capable of extension and recoil. Okay, capable of extension and as well as recoil. This tissue can recoil to its original shape. So after the extension, it may come to its original shape due to the having the nature of recoil. So that is the elastic. Due to the presence of elastic fibers, it is having such type of nature. Occur in the walls of arteries and vocal cords and trachea and bronchi. Where it is usually appeared means in the walls of arteries and vocal cords, trachea and bronchi. Okay, now go for the diagrams of the dense connective tissue of regular, irregular and elastic. Okay, now here you are observing the regular dense connective tissue and dense. This is the first one is the dense regular, second one is the irregular. So in this picture you are able to see the fibers which are arranged parallel regularly in a systematic manner, but in case of irregular, the fibers are arranged in zigzag manner. Okay, that is the irregular and this one is the regular. Okay, now coming to the elastic fibers. So this is the elastic connective tissue which is having the nature of extension and recoil. Okay, so this is about the dense connective tissue. Next, we go for the next tissue. Now, supporting connective tissue. In connective tissue, already we have completed the loose and dense connective tissues. The next topic is the supporting connective tissue. Supporting means which gives support to the body. The supporting connective tissue, otherwise called as the skeletal tissue also. Here it is of two types. One is the cartilage and second one is the bone. Cartilage. Cartilage, semi-solid matrix. Bone, solid matrix. Cartilage is again in three types. Hyaline cartilage and fibrocartilage and elastic. Bone is of two types, compact and spongy. Okay, so if we go for the picture, so usually everybody knows how the bones looks like and how the cartilage look like. Okay, now go for the next slide for detail. Here, the definition for the skeletal tissue is, it is the endoskeleton of the vertebrates and support the body and protect various organs, provide surface for the attachment of muscles and helps in locomotion. What is the main use of the skeletal tissue? It form the endoskeleton. Endo means which is present innerly of vertebrates. And it supports the body, protect various organs, provide surface for the attachment of muscles and help in locomotion. Especially when it attach with the muscles, it will be useful for the locomotion. Okay. It is of two types. Just now only we discussed cartilage and bone. First we go for the cartilage. Cartilage is a solid but semi-rigid connective tissue. Matrix is a firm but somewhat pliable, means flexible. Matrix is a firm but somewhat pliable, means is able to flexible. It has collagen fibers, elastic fibers and matrix secreting cells called chondroblast. Okay, so when we observe the cartilage, it is made up of with collagen fibers and elastic fibers and matrix secreting cells known as a chondroblast. So these cells are enclosed in the fluid filled spaces called lacunae. So the chondroblast cells which are present in a fluid filled spaces called as a lacunae. Chondrocytes are the active cells of a cartilage. Chondroblasts are immature, are not active that much, but chondrocytes are active cells of the cartilage. Cartilage is surrounded by a fibrous connective tissue sheath called as a perichondrium. Outer side, if it is present, peri. Cartilage is surrounded by a fibrous connective tissue sheath called as a perichondrium. Cartilage is avascular. Avascular means it is not having the blood vessels. So how the nourishment takes place? It is nourished by diffusion of materials from the blood capillaries of a perichondrium. The perichondrium, which is giving the covering sheath, it is having blood vessels. So from that particular portion, by the diffusion process, the nourishment takes place. Growth and regeneration and repair of cartilage takes place by the activity of perichondrial cells. Means the perichondrium, which is giving the covering, is useful for the regeneration, repair of cartilage, and it takes active part. So that is known as a perichondrial cell. Okay, this is about the cartilage. So once again, I am repeating. Cartilage is solid but semi-rigid connective tissue. Matrix is firm but somewhat pliable, means it is having some flexibility. It has collagen fibers and elastic fibers. The matrix secreting cells are called as chondroblasts. Chondrocytes are active cells of cartilage. Cartilage is surrounded by a fibrous connective tissue sheath called perichondrium. Cartilage is avascular. Avascular means which is not having the blood vessels. So nourishment takes place by the diffusion process from the perichondrium. Means perichondrium is having with the blood supply, blood capillaries. From that particular portion, it is able to gain the nutrients by the diffusion process. Growth, regeneration, repair of cartilage takes place by the activity of perichondrial cells. Okay? So this is about cartilage. Here the cartilage are again divided into three types. So in that, the first one is the hyaline cartilage. Okay, what is the term? Hyaline cartilage. Okay, first go for the points. It is bluish white, transparent and glass like cartilage. How it look like? It is bluish white and transparent and glass like cartilage. It is the weakest and the most common type of all the cartilages. So among three, it is the weakest and most common type of the cartilage. Perichondrium is present. So when you are observing the picture, perichondrium is present. It forms the embryonic endoskeleton of bony vertebrates. Embryonic endoskeleton means at the time of embryo stages, endoskeleton is made up of with hyaline cartilage. And endoskeleton of cyclostomes. In case of cyclostome, it will be continuously present. And cartilaginous fishes also. So that is about the hyaline cartilage. So perichondrium is present. Due to the presence of perichondrium, it is able to nourish it by the diffusion process. Okay. Here you are able to see the chondrocyte and extracellular matrix. Okay. Chondroblasts. So it is a bluish white color. Hyaline cartilage is bluish white color, transparent, glass-like cartilage. Okay. This is the first one. It is the weakest and the most common type of all the cartilages. Perichondrium is present. It forms the embryonic endoskeleton of bony vertebrates. Only in embryonic stages only it will be present in case of bony vertebrates. And endoskeleton of cyclostomes and cartilaginous fishes. So this is about hyaline cartilage. Got it? Okay. Now, the second one is the elastic cartilage. It is yellow in color, even though it is appearing in a blue color, but it is usually it is having the yellow color. Due to the elastic fibers, which type of fibers are present? Elastic fibers are present. Matrix has abundance of yellow elastic fibers in addition to collagen fibers. So collagen fibers are also present. In addition to them, elastic fibers are also present. It provides strength and elasticity. What is the nature? Elasticity. Perichondrium is present. Here also you are able to see the perichondrium. It is found in the pinnae of external ears. External ears, when we fold them, they just fold for a second and afterwards they will come to their original position. And Eustachian tubes and epiglottis. In that particular areas, we are able to see elastic cartilage. Okay, so this is about elastic cartilage. Once again, it is yellow in color due to the elastic fibers, presence of elastic fibers. Matrix has abundance of elastic fibers in addition to collagen fibers. It provides strength and elasticity. Perichondrium is present. It is found in the pinnae of external ears and Eustachian tubes and epiglottis. Okay, this is about elastic cartilage. The third one is the fibrocartilage, otherwise fibrous cartilage. Matrix has bundles of collagen fibers. Collagen fibers are present maximum, but no perichondrium. No perichondrium. Perichondrium is not present. It is the strongest of all types of cartilages. It occurs in the intervertebral disc. So where it will be present? Intervertebral disc. Okay. Matrix has bundles of collagen fibers. Fibrous, very tough in structure also. Perichondrium is absent. It is the strongest of all types of cartilages. It occurs in the intervertebral disc. Okay. So this is about fibrous cartilage. Now coming to bone. Just now only we discussed Skeletal tissue is divided into two types, that is the bone and cartilage. Already cartilage is completed. Now coming to the bone topic. Here, the bone is highly calcified, otherwise mineralized, solid, hard, and rigid connective tissue. In case of cartilage, semi-rigid, but here completely rigid. Solids, complete solid and rigid. It is a major component of the endoskeleton of most adult vertebrates. Endoskeleton means the skeleton which is present innerly. It is the main tissue that provides structural framework to the body. It supports the soft tissues, protect the delicate organs. So can you guess how our shape will be if we are not having the bones? Just like simple, like a ball-like structure. Because due to the presence of bones only, we are having a proper shape and proper structure. So it is giving protection and protecting the delicate organs also. Bones also interact with muscles attached to them to bring about movements. So when bones attach with the muscles, so they are useful for the movement, just like the bones which are present in our hands and legs. Bones have a non-pliable, non-flexible matrix, rich in calcium salts and collagen fibers. Bone is highly vascular. It is very, very important. It is a highly vascular, means it is having linked with the blood vessels. Bone has an outer fibrous connective tissue sheath. It is called as a peri. If it is a, always you remember that when any tissue which is present outside, maximum you are giving the term as peri, periosteum. The inner connective tissue sheath that lines the marrow cavity is called as a endosteum. Okay, we go for the periosteum and endosteum terms for the next slide. Okay. Now, go for the next slide. Bone cells include osteoblasts, osteocytes, and osteoclasts. These are the three types of terms. Okay, go for one by one. First one is the osteoblast. Immature bone cells secrete the organic components like collagen fibers of matrix and also play an important role in mineralization. So immature bone cells are called as the osteoblast, and they play a vital role in mineralization, and they become as osteocytes. After the mineralization, osteoblasts are modified as the osteocytes. Otherwise, they call as the mature bone cells. Osteocytes are enclosed in fluid-filled portions known as the lacunae. And the third type cells are known as the osteoclasts, are phagocytic cells involved in demineralization. Means osteoblasts are useful for the mineralization and osteoclasts are useful for the demineralization. Okay, this is about some regarding points of the bones. The cells of bone are osteoblast, osteocyte, and osteoclast. Osteoblasts are the immature bone cells, secrete the organic components of matrix, and also play important role in the mineralization of the bone and become osteocytes. After the mineralization only, the osteoblasts are called as the osteocytes, or mature bone cells. Osteocytes are enclosed in a fluid-filled portion that is known as the lacunae. So we will see all these in the next coming picture. Osteoclasts. Osteoclasts are the phagocytic cells involved in demineralization. Okay. Types of bones based on the structure. Again, we are grouping the bones based upon the structure into two types. Number one is the spongy bones and number two is the compact bone. Okay, let's go for the topic. here. First one is the spongy bone. Okay. It occurs in the epiphysis and metaphysis of lung bones. So first of all, we have to know what is epiphysis and what is metaphysis. And it looks spongy and contains columns of bones called trabeculae. So when you are observing, it is a having number of a sponge-like structure. Here you are able to see the sponge-like structure. Irregular interspaces. They are not having a proper shape. Irregular interspaces filled with a red bone marrow. How they are filled means with a red bone marrow. This is about some points of spongy bone. It occurs in epiphysis. Now, let me discuss about epiphysis and metaphysis. Okay. So, here in this picture, so epi means which is upper side. And a long bone is having two edges which are wide in structure are known, that particular portion is known as a epiphysis. Here we are observing only one part, that is the upper side epiphysis zone. So this is the part of upper side epiphyseal zone. So in that particular regard, we are observing the cells are arranged in an irregular manner and the irregular spaces are filled with a red bone marrow. And that is the reason it is appearing like a sponge-like structure. We are giving the term as a spongy bone. Usually such type of structure will also observe to the bottom side also. Okay. But in here in this picture, we are observing for only for the upper side only. So usually a long bone is consisting with a epiphysis. And between the two epiphyseal places, a diaphysis will be present. So when we are discussing for spongy bone part, so especially spongy bone part means epiphyseal place and metaphyse. Meta means the place between the epi and diaphysis, middle place is known as the meta. Okay. So especially when we are talking about the spongy bone, it is present at the epiphysis region and irregular interspaces and which are filled with the red bone marrow. And totally it look like the sponge-like structure. This is about spongy bone. It is a part of bone which is present in the epiphyseal region, having irregular shape, so irregular places which are filled with the red bone marrow. Totally it will look like the sponge-like structure. Okay, so this is about the spongy bone. Now, compact bone. So in a compact bone, diaphysis is a part of long bone. Okay, diaphysis. Just now only I explain you. Diaphysis means the middle portion of the long bone is known as a diaphysis. And the remaining two portions are known as a epi. Two epiphyseal places. And in between the two epiphyseal places, the bone region is called as a diaphysis. Diaphysis is the part of a long bone that lies in between expanded ends of epiphyses. Got it? In a growing bone, there is a region called metaphysis between the diaphysis and epiphysis. Dia and epi. Dia means middle portion of the long bone. Epiphysis means upper region, upper portion of the long bone. It consists of epiphyseal plate. So there we are able to see a plate-like structure that is known as the epiphyseal. That will be observed in the coming picture. formed by hyaline cartilage. It help in the elongation of the bone. How the elongation of the bone takes place? Mean with the help of the epiphyseal plate, which is formed by the hyaline cartilage. Diaphysis is covered by a dense connective fibrous tissue called periosteum. Peri means outer side, completely out. Diaphysis is a long bone, has a hollow cavity called marrow cavity, and which is surrounded by endosteum. In between the periosteum and endosteum, the mark of the bone laid down in the form of lamellae. So outer circumferential. Okay, next it is better to go for the diagram, then onwards we will discuss all these points. Okay, now first we go for the diagram. Okay, so this is the compact bone. Otherwise, we may also term it to look like a long bone-like structure. Okay, so here in this picture, we will completely observe what are the parts are there. Here, this is the epiphyseal region and epiphyseal line. So here you are able to see a line like structure here. Just I am zooming it. So here you are able to see a plate like structure that is known as a epiphyseal line. And endosteum. Endosteum means it is present innerly. Okay. Epiphysis. So proximal epiphysis. And meta means this is the somewhat a region between the dia means, so from the place between the epiphyseal to the place between the two epiphyseal region is called as a diaphysis, and the place between the epiphysis and diaphysis is known as a metaphysis. Okay, the first point is the epiphysis, which is present completely upper side. And the place between the two epiphyseal region is called as the diaphysis. This is completely diaphysis. And the place between the epi and dia is called as the metaphysis. And epiphyseal line, just now only I explained. So with the help of this line only, there is a chance of elongation of bone takes place. This is a line-like structure which is present at that particular region of metaphysis. Is useful for the elongation of the bone. Okay. Now, so here also you are observing the epiphysis. This is the distal epiphysis, that is the proximal epiphysis. Between these two epiphyseal regions, we are having the diaphysis. Okay. And diaphysis and epiphyseal region middle portion is known as the metaphysis. Totally three terms are there. First one is the epiphysis, which is exactly at the top and bottom regions. The top region epiphysis is known as a here proximal epiphysis, and the bottom region epiphysis is known as a distal epiphysis. And between these two regions is known as the diaphysis. And the place between the diaphysis and epiphyseal region is called as the metaphysis. Okay, so these are the three regions you have to remember: epiphysis, diaphysis, and meta. Meta means the term itself. Meta means middle. Where middle? Between the dia and epi. Dia means the middle portion, in a long bone, the middle portion of the particular bone part is known as the diaphysis. Okay, so these are the terms you have to remember. Here, again, we are discussing the points. So diaphysis is a part of long bone. Just now only I explained, that lies in between the expanded ends means epiphyses. In a growing bone, there is a region called metaphyses between the dia and epiphyses. It consists of an epiphyseal plate, okay, and formed by hyaline cartilage. It helps in the elongation of the bone. Diaphysis is covered by a dense connective tissue called as a periosteum, outer side, which is covering, that is known as a periosteum. Diaphysis of a long bone has a hollow cavity called as a marrow cavity, which is surrounded, innerly it is surrounded by endosteum. In between the periosteum and endosteum, the mark of the bone is laid down in the form of lamellae. Okay, so that will be explained with the help of next picture. Okay, so I think you got the clarity regarding diaphysis and metaphysis and epiphysis. Okay, now we go for the next points. Here, Haversian system. So in Haversian system, space between the Haversian system are filled with interstitial lamellae. Haversian system consists of Haversian canal that run parallel to the marrow cavity. It contains an artery, a vein, and lymphatic vessel. So with the help of this speaker, we will have the clear idea. Okay. So this is the periosteum. Just now only I told you. Periosteum means the long bone outer covering fibrous connective tissue is called as a periosteum. And the inner endosteum. This is the periosteum and this is the endosteum. In between these two regions, the matrix is present in the form of a lamellae. So this is the outer circumferential lamellae. Okay. And this is the inner circumferential lamellae. The matrix which is present between the periosteum and endosteum is laid down in the form of lamellae, which is exactly to the outside, just beneath the periosteum, is called as the outer circumferential lamellae, and just beneath the endosteum is called as the inner circumferential lamellae. And here you are observing round structures which are known as the Haversian canal. This is the round, inner round is called as the Haversian canal, and entire portion is called as the Haversian system. The place between the Haversian systems is called as the interstitial lamellae. Here you are able to see the interstitial lamellae. The place between the two Haversian systems is called, is filled with the interstitial lamellae. Again, I am explaining once again. Here we are grouping the matrix portion of a periosteum and endosteum, and that is laid in the form of lamellae. Exactly which is present to the outer side, just beneath the periosteum, is called as the outer circumferential lamellae, and just above the endosteum is called as the inner circumferential lamellae. And here the Haversian system, the place which is present between two Haversian systems, is filled with the interstitial lamellae. The inner round portion, dark color portion, is called as the Haversian canal. So here you are able to see the bone marrow, which is exactly innerly present. Periosteum, endosteum, and then onwards you are observing the bone marrow. Okay. Now go for the detailed points. I think you got the perfection regarding the terms of three. Here you are learning three new terms. Those are outer circumferential lamellae. What do you mean by lamellae? The matrix region which is present between the periosteum and endosteum is laid down in the form of lamellae. So exactly which is outside, outer circumferential. Exactly which is inside, above the endosteum, that is the inner. and between the two Haversian systems is called as a interstitial. Totally three types of lamellas we are observing. Okay. Here the T is not spelled. The space between the Haversian system are filled with the interstitial lamella. Just now only I told you the space between the Haversian systems are filled with the interstitial lamella. Okay. And Haver system consists of a Haversian canal that runs parallel to the marrow cavity. It contains an artery, a vein, and lymphatic vessel. So now go for this first pick, then you will have the clarity. Okay. Here, Haversian canal, which is a completely middle, entire Haversian system or osteon. Okay. And osteocyte, the fluid portion is known as the lacunae. Here, this one is the osteocyte, and the fluid which is present in it is called as a lacunae, and the thread-like structures which are extend the cell process units are called as a canaliculi, and the entire portion is known as a osteon. The Haversian canal, which is surrounded by the concentric lamellae. Concentric lamellae means here you are observing a round concentric lamellae portion. The entire unit means here the Haversian canal and the lamellae of concentric and lacunae and canaliculi. All these consist osteon or Haversian system. So these are present in between the portion of periosteum and endosteum. Okay, here we are observing the first one is the Haversian canal, which is having an artery, a vein, and a lymphatic vessel, and it runs parallel with to the bone marrow cavity, and it is surrounded by the concentric lamellae, which are having the osteocytes, and which osteocytes are present in the fluid-filled portion that is known as the lacunae, and the thread-like structures are called as the canaliculi, and all these are completely altogether called as the osteon or Haversian system. Okay. Here, the space between the Haversian system are filled with interstitial lamellae. Haversian system consists of a Haversian canal that run parallel to the bone marrow cavity. It contains an artery, a vein, and lymphatic vessel. Haversian canal is surrounded by concentric lamellae. Small fluid filled spaces are called as lacunae, provided with minute canaliculi, and totally altogether called as a Haversian canal. Already we all discussed all these points with the help of that diagram. So here, this is the Haversian system. In that Haversian canal, this is the lacunae. This is the canaliculi, and these are the concentric lamellae. All together, it is called as the Haversian canal or osteon, Haversian system or osteon. Okay. The cytoplasmic process of osteocytes extend through canaliculi. Just now only we see from the lacunae portion is a small thread-like structure is coming out that is known as a what we are calling them cytoplasmic process. And Haversian canal and surrounding lamellae are collectively called as Haversian system or osteon. Haversian system canal communicate with another with periosteum and also with marrow cavity by a canal called as a Oakman's canal. Here, lastly, you are observing. So this is about the once again. Epiphysis, this is the epiphyseal plate, periosteum, endosteum. Here in this picture, you are able to see peri means outside, endo means here. The pink color is the marrow cavity, which is surrounded by the endosteum. Here you are able to see the between the space which is filled by the lamellar region, outer circumferential, inner circumferential, interstitial and concentric lamellus. Especially when we are talking about the Haversian system, it is having a canal-like structure which is having linked with the marrow cavity, that is known as the Oakman's canal. So I think you got all these points. Next, go for the assignment. What we have learned. So today we discussed about the skeletal connective tissue, that is cartilage and bone. In cartilage, hyaline cartilage, fibrocartilage, elastic, and in bone, compact and spongy bone. Assignment. Describe the three types of cartilage. First question. Explain the Haversian system. Second question. Describe the structure of a compact bone. Third question. I repeat questions once again. Describe the three types of cartilage. Second question is the explain Haversian system. Third question is describe the structure of a compact bone.